So far, in our class of the tafsir of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the explanation of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the seer of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we've covered the hijrah of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the hijrah of the Sahaba, from Mecca to Medina. And we looked at the environment they arrived in Medina. And thereafter that, we covered the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa sahibuhu Abu Bakr and his companion Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And we paused on that for quite a while. We looked at the strategies, the planning, organization, and execution of the plan of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in making the hijrah from Mecca to Medina. And we also looked at the incidences that happened on the way to hijrah to Medina. And one of those incidences, or one of the camps that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed by, was the camp of Ummu Ma'bad. We also looked at the reception which the Ansar gave the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam upon arriving in Medina, and also the first thing that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did upon reaching Medina, which is to do what? Build the masjid. So far in the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, based on the tafsir of the ayat we're doing, we've reached the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, this means we've moved into a new phase when it comes to the explanation of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because as we mentioned in Khutbah Jumu'ah, in the Quran, the surah, the chapters of two types, Makkiyah and Madaniyah, Meccan surah and Madani surah. And as we've defined from the previous classes, surah al-Makkiyah, who could tell me what a surah Makkiyah, a Meccan surah is, and who could tell me what a Madani surah is? Ya Luqman. Jazakallah khairan. Any surah, any chapter that's revealed before the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Makkiyah, even if it was revealed outside Mecca. And any surah that was revealed after the hijrah is Madaniyah, even if it was revealed outside Medina or in Mecca. Who could give me an example of a surah that's revealed outside Medina, in fact in Mecca? Or ayah? إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح. That's an example. Another one that revealed. بارك الله فيك. إن فتحنا لك فتحا مبينا. This was revealed during the Sulh al Hudaybiyah. So this was revealed in Mecca, but it's what? It's a Medina surah because it revealed after the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So therefore, what we're going to be looking at from now on is Surah al Madaniyah, the Medina surah. And as we're going through them, you're going to see certain characteristics of this surah, of these chapters, which are Madaniyah, that when you read the Quran, you could tell immediately, this is a Medina surah or a Meccan surah. So the first surah we're going to be looking at, inshallah ta'ala, today, is the first surah to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the surah we're going to look at, first and foremost, as we always do, if there's any excellence of that surah, the fadl, excellence of that surah, mention excellence. Secondly, we look at the mawdu', the topic or subject matter of that surah. Because the Quran, those ayats have mawdu'. So if you have 50 ayah, for example, ayah number 1 to 5 could be one particular topic. 6 to 11, another topic. So we're going to look at the mawdu' of the surah. And lastly, we look at the durus, the lessons we could take from that surah, from that chapter. The first surah to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina was Surah Al-Baqarah. So awwal suwar, by ijma' of the ulama, by consensus of the ulama, the first surah to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina was Surah Al-Baqarah. The only ikhtilaf is the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wattaqu yawman turja'una fihi ila Allah. And fear the day you be returned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is Surah Al-Baqarah. Some say this is the last thing to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before his death. But as for Baqarah, there's ijma' consensus. This is the first surah al-madaniyah. The first Medina surah to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was Surah Al-Baqarah. As for the excellence of this surah, Surah Al-Baqarah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, in the Musnad, Imam Ahmad, Al-Tirmidhi, and Muslim, the hadith of Nawas ibn Sam'an, he said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about Surah Al-Baqarah, yu'ta بالقرآن وأهله الذين كان يعملون به في الدنيا. That يوم القيامة, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring forth the Qur'an wa ahlihi together and the people of the Qur'an on yawm al-qiyamah, those who acted according to the Qur'an. تَقْدُمُهُمْ سُورَةُ الْبَقَرَةُ وَسُورَةَ الْعِمْرَانِ. And these people, the people of the Qur'an, they will be led forth by Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Al-Imran. Nawas ibn Sam'an, he said, ثُمَّ ضَرَبَ ثَلَاثَ أَمْثِلَةَ مَا زِلْتُ أَوْ مَا نَسِيتُهُنَّ بَعْدُ. I've not forgotten these three examples of the similitude of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam he gave concerning Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Al-Imran. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كَأَنَّهُمَا, on that day, يوم القيامة, كَأَنَّهُمَا غَمَامَتَان. On that day, there will be like two clouds. أَوْ كَأَنَّهُمَا, on that day, there will be like ظُلَّتَان سَوْدَوَان. There will be like two black shades. أَوْ كَأَنَّهُمَا فِرْقَان, on that day, there will be like فِرْقَان, two groups of birds in two rows, صَفَّين, in two rows, shading the people, يوم القيامة. تُحَجَّان عَنْ صَاحِبِهِمَا, that will argue and fight and defend the people of the Qur'an. Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Al-Imran. They'll come and shade يوم القيامة. And what is the significance of the shade يوم القيامة? What is the significance of the shade يوم القيامة? Because يوم القيامة, there is no trees, there's no building, there's nowhere for anyone to shade themselves. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَوْمَ تُبَدَّلُ الْأَرْضُ غَيْرَ الْأَرْضِ وَالسَّمَاوَاتِ. يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, the earth will be exchanged for a new earth, and the heavens for another heavens. No one have anywhere to be shaded. But Surah Baqarah and Surah Ali Imran, they will shade the people, their people, يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, and they will argue on their behalf, يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, تَعَلَّمُ سُورَةَ الْبَقَرَةِ, learn Surah Al-Baqarah, فَإِنَّ أَخْذَهَا بَرَكَةَ وَتَرُكُهَا حَسْرَةَ. Learn Surah Al-Baqarah, for learning it is barakah, is blessing. And ignoring it and abandoning Surah Al-Baqarah is a cause of sorrow. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to say, وَلَا يَسْتَطِيعُهَا, nobody is able to learn Baqarah min al-batala, from the people of sorcery and the magicians. So learn Surah Al-Baqarah. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the rawi of the hadith Burayda, he said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, thumma sakata, and then he kept quiet, and then he repeated, said, ta'allamu Surah Al-Baqarah wa Ali Imran. Learn Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Ali Imran. For verily these two will come yawm al-qiyamah ghamamatan, as two clouds, two dark shades and two dark shades, يوم القيامة. From the excellence of this surah, Surah Al-Baqarah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا تجعلوا بيوتكم مقابر إن الشيطان ينفر من البيت الذي تقرأ فيه Surah Al-Baqarah. Do not make your house become like graveyards. Meaning, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your homes. For shaitan, he flees from any household in which Surah Al-Baqarah is recited. And that's why you find some people, when they get home sometimes, and they find, subhanAllah, for no reason at all, their family, be it their wife or whatever, is in a bad mood, she just snapping for no reason. Immediately they take out Surah Al-Baqarah and start to read Surah Al-Baqarah. And the mood in the house, the feeling in the house, it changes. So Surah Al-Baqarah is something we should recite constantly in our house. And it's not difficult to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah بإذن الله تعالى. As Allah Ta'ala said, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرَنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرٍ. That we've made the Qur'an easy to remember. Is there anybody that wishes to remember? But at the very least, try to read or memorize the last two ayahs of Surah Al-Baqarah, which starts with آمَنَ الرَّسُولُ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْهِ مِن رَبِّهِ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, اِقْرَهُ آتَيْن آيَتَيْن اللَّتَيْن في آخر سورة البقرة. Read these two, هاتين آيتين اللتين, that in the end of سورة البقرة. فإنها من تحت العرش. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he took out these two ayah from under his throne, the last two ayah of سورة البقرة. عظيمة جدا. Allah ta'ala أخرجها, Allah took it out from under his عرش. And this is the important aqidah. Anybody who studies aqeedah, creed, and belief will know the importance of the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the greatness of the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The arsh, shay'un azim, that you could not even imagine. Because when you compare the kursi, which is the footstool of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say about the kursi? Wasi'a kursiyuhu samawati wal ard. The kursi, it fills the vastness of the heavens and the earth. And what is the example of the kursi to the example of the seven heavens and the seven earth? What's the example, the similitude? A ring in the desert. And the kursi compared to the arsh is that what? That ring in the desert. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these last two ayah of Surah 2, Baqarah, took it from under arsh. I remember once, this was about 17 years ago, I was traveling. No problem. I remember about 17 or 18 years ago, I was traveling to Nigeria. And as we know, traditionally, people have their traditional way of Islam. And some of it is correct, some of it is not correct. So for example, for Barakah, people say Fatiha. For Barakah, they'll say, by the grace of. What's the grace of in Yoruba? Ola ina atoina. By the grace of inna atoina kel kawthar. So I remember I was traveling to Nigeria, I was on a plane. 18 years ago, this is the first time I met Brother Suleiman, or second time in Nigeria. And subhanAllah, was about to land. And Nigeria, if you ever watch a documentary called Lagos Airport, you know the ahwal, the situation of Nigerian airports. We were to land, and the weather was very bad. Severe weather. We was above Lagos, circulating for maybe 30 to 45 minutes. We couldn't land. No communication between the pilot and air traffic control. So we're just in the air like this. People screaming, people shouting, people praying. And some people causing more panic. I remember there was a man on the plane saying, you know, these Nigerians, they carry a lot of luggage, the fuel is going to run out, we're going to die. And I remember, alhamdulillah, we landed safely. You know, and one of the first people I came across was a Muslim woman. She said, alhamdulillah, you know, I had no fear whatsoever. You know, because of Aman al-Rasul, subhanAllah. This was just an ordinary woman who had what you not even say, hijab al-shari'i. She said to me, how could you ever be scared? And she said to me in Yoruba, as long as Aman al-Rasul is there. The last two ayah of Surah al-Baqarah. So these are the fada'il, or some of the excellence of Surah al-Baqarah. As for the mawdu', the topic of the surah, usually when we look at the mawdu' of a surah, they're never this large in size. Surah al-Baqarah is large in size. The longer surah, jayid? So the mawdu' of the surah, sahibu, the author of the book Ma'arij at-tafakkur wa daqa'iq at-tadabbur. It said Surah al-Baqarah could be divided into five basic categories. Five basic categories. And these branches or these categories, they have subcategories. They connect one to the other. But we're not going to go into the subcategories because the subcategories or the lessons going to about 47. So we're going to go into the five main parts of Surah al-Baqarah. The five main parts of Surah al-Baqarah, he mentions, he said the first part of Surah al-Baqarah is this. That al-far'u al-awwal of Surah al-Baqarah is Al-Qur'an al-Majid, the glorious Qur'an, al-Mu'jaz, that is a miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa hidayatihi, and is a what? It's a form of guidance. So when we look at the biggest Surah al-Baqarah, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, that this is a book, there's no doubt. And the Qur'an, or the first part of it, the first branch, explains the hal, the condition of mushakkikun, those who doubt in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and abstain from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-far'u al-thani, the second category of these ayats, or mudu', the second topic, Baqarah, daraba amthila. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Baqarah strikes similitude from history, fil hayati dunya, concerning the light of this life of this world. Mudu' al-imtihan. So Surah Baqarah, the topic is about imtihan, test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concerning the people's stance or the jinn stance concerning the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it starts with what? The orders and prohibition test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concerning al-awamil nawahi. So it begins with the story of who? Iblis. And the test and the order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to what? To Iblis. And then the story of who? Adam alayhi salam. Imtihan. And then he goes on and give example of previous umam banu Israel. So in Surah Baqarah, you find a lot of Ya Bani Israel. Ya Bani Israel. And warning to this ummah not to follow the example of Bani Israel. Al-Faru al-Thalith. The second topic matter in Surah Baqarah. Al-Mu'minun al-Muttaqoon. The believers, those who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this comes in the beginning of what? Surah Al-Baqarah. Huda lil man? Lil muttaqeen. For those who are muttaqeen, who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what is the attributes? Al-Ladhina yu'minuna. What they believe in? In Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wal-Yawm al-Akhir. And the last day. The fourth topic matter is Al-Kafirun ghayr mustajibin. Is the disbelievers who do not answer the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that have reached a level of no hope. In Surah Al-Baqarah. And where is this ayah? إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَأَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرُهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Those who disbelieve, it is the same for them. Whether you warn them or you do not warn them, they will never ever believe. خَتَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ. Allah sealed their hearts. And those who are disbelievers, but they still hope to get them into Iman. And the fifth subject matter is Al-Munafiqoon. The Munafiqoon, the hypocrites. Because prior to Medina, there was not issues with the Munafiqoon. The issue of Nifaq, it began where? In Medina. In Medina. So anytime you find Surah that talks about the Munafiqoon, they usually Surah of where? Medina. Because the Amr of the Munafiqoon, very, very dangerous. When it comes to the believers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described them in how many ayat? 5. Ulaika humul muflihun. The end of the ayah. Begin Surah Baqarah. When it comes to the kuffar, the non-believers, Allah described them in ayah 2. When it comes to the Munafiqoon, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described them in ayah 14 ayat. I mean 13 or 14? 13 ayat. 13 ayat. Because these people, they make iman apparent while they hide kufr. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّ بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ مَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. From mankind also, we believe in Allah in the last day, and they're not believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, due to the danger of the munafiqoon, Allah ta'ala said that a complete surah al-munafiqoon. Surah al-munafiqoon, because they're not easy to tell. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the munafiqoon, when you see them, tu'ajibuka ajsamuhum, the outward appearance will impress you. Wa in yaqulu tasma' liqawlihim. So sweet to their word, so eloquent that when they speak, you listen to that which they say. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, humul adu fahdharhum. They are not aduun, they're not an enemy, but Allah ta'ala says, humul adu. What's the difference between aduun and al-adu? Aduun is, they are an enemy. Al-adu, they what? They are the enemy. It's though as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, you have no other enemy but them, the munafiqoon. Humul adu, they are the enemy. And that's why I find a lot of ayat al-madaniyah, it deals with the munafiqoon, wa jihad, fighting against the munafiqoon. Wa jihad against the munafiqoon is what? Bil lisan, with the tongue, with proof and argument and evidences. Because the munafiqoon, they are people that come with proof and evidence and doubts. And that's why they're very close to the who? The people of the book, the Yahud in Medina. Just in the same way today, Islam and the Muslim Ummah has never been defeated except through who? The munafiqoon, and those who take on the aqeedah of the Yahud from the Muslim sects. The munafiqoon. So therefore, it's important to defeat them with knowledge and with dalil. And this shows the importance of knowledge. And that's how Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah ta'ala, from his mashayikh and from a point of benefit. Yusuf is sheikh, and his sheikh said to him, Ta'al urika silahan jahaztuhu li ahli majma'. That come, let me show you some weapons. Weapons of mass destruction I've prepared for the people of Majma'. So Muhammad Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah ta'ala entered. And when he entered, it was a library full of books of the people of knowledge. Importance of ilm. Tayyib. So this is the last mawdu' of Surah Al-Baqarah. And like we said, when it comes to the surah, we're going to go through those who have asbab al-nuzul, a cause or reason of what? Revelation behind it. We're not going to go through the whole of Surah Al-Baqarah, but rather those who have sabab al-nuzul. So the first ayah bi sabab al-nuzul that has a cause of revelation, Surah Al-Baqarah, is the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah in verse 79. The saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَوَيْلُ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ لَيَشْتَرُوا بِهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا فَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا كَتَبَتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا يَكْسُبُونَ. Woe unto those who write the books with their hands. Sheikh Muqbil rahimahullah ta'ala, in his book As-Sahih al-Musnad min Asbab al-Nuzul, that which has been authentically reported concerning sabab al-nuzul, it said, nuzilat fi ahli al-kitab. This was sent down concerning the people of the book. We'll write the book, bi-aydihim, thumma yaqulun. And then they say, hadha min indillah. This from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Woe unto these people. Nuzilat fi ahli al-kitab. And this one of the ways you know Surah al-Madaniyah, because this is one of their first interaction with who? The people of the book. The second one after this to come down, was, I'm going to look at the durus of this after, from the had a sabab al-nuzul, is the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ كِتَابٌ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ مُصَدِّقٌ لِمَا مَعَهُمْ وَكَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلِ يَسْتَفْتِحُونَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ مَا عَرَفُوا كَفَرُوا بِهِ فَلَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. Is verse number 89, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ كِتَابٌ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ, when a book came to them, the Ahlul Kitab from the Jews, min indillah, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not only is it from Allah, so they did not doubt, musaddiqun lima ma'ahum, that only testified and confirms that which they had with them. Wa kanu min qabl, and before this book came to them, yastaftihun, they used to pray for victories against the disbeliever, the Ahlul Kitab, and then that came to them. فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ مَا عَرَفُوا, and then when that which they recognized, they knew, not that were ignorant of, they knew came to them, كَفَرُوا بِهِ, they disbelieved in it. فَلَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ, and what is that came to them, that they knew and they recognized? La, what came to them that they really recognized? We're going to look at, and we've done the tafsir of this ayah before. What is it that came to them? We don't, huh? Jazakallah khairan. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because in the tafsir, we don't prove this ayah, was sabab al-nuzul. The reason Allah ta'ala revealed this ayah is that Ibn Ishaq, he mentioned hadith that the Ansar, they said, innama da'ana ila al-islam ma'a rahmatillahi wa huda lana lima kunna nasma' min rijah al-yahud. That when the Ansar, they came to give the bay'ah to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of the things that brought them to Islam, other than the mercy and the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is what they used to hear from the Yahud. He said, "Kunna ahlu shirk wa ashab al-awthan," were people of shirk and idolatry. "Wa kanu ahlu kitab indahum in laysa lana," and the people of the book, meaning the Yahud, they had knowledge which did not have. "Wa kanat la tazal baynana wa baynahum shuru, fa idha nilna minhum ba'da ma yakrahun qalu lana," and when we used to do things to them that they used to hate, and we used to avenge and torture them and punish them and oppress them, he said that the people of the book, the Jews, used to say, إِنَّهُ قَدْ تَقَارَبَ زَمَانُ النَّبِيِّ يُبْعَثَ الْآنَ نَقْتُلُكُمْ مَعَكُمْ قَتْلَ عَادٍ وَإِرْمٍ. That they used to say to the mushrikeen of Medina, that do not worry. You see, you're doing this to us now, the people of the book. The time has now come near for the raising of a prophet. That this prophet, when he comes, we're going to fight you and we're going to destroy you as Allah Ta'ala destroyed the Ad. فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ, and when that came to them, كَفَرُوا بِهِ, even though they knew him to the extent Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ. They know the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ. The same way they know their own children to this level. So this is the second ayah to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that had a sabab al-nuzul, a cause of revelation. The next one after this is ayah number 97 in Surah Al-Baqarah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِجِبْرِيلَ فَإِنَّهُ نَزَّلُهُ عَلَى قَلْبِكَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ وَهُدًى وَبُشْرَى لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Whoever is an enemy to Jibreel, فَإِنَّهُ نَزَّلَهُ عَلَى قَلْبِكَ. He's the one that sent it down upon your heart by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, affirming that which is in front of him, وَهُدًى and guidance, وَبُشْرَى لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ, a guidance and a glad tidings to the believers. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala says, سبب النزول هذه الآية from the seerah is that the Yahud, they went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they say, يَا أَبَا الْقَاسِمِ إِنَّ نَسْأَلُكَ عَنْ خَمْسَةِ أَشْيَاءَ فَإِنْ أَنْبَأْتَنَا بِهِنَّ عَرَفْنَا أَنَّكَ نَبِيٌّ وَاتَّبَعْنَاكَ. We're going to ask you about five things only. If you can inform of these five things, we will follow you. We will know that you're a prophet and we should follow you. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took from them a mithaq, a covenant. The same mithaq Israel, it took from his children. He said, and they said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَاللَّهُ عَلَى مَا نَقُولُ وَكِيلُ. Allah is a wakil over that which we say. Jayyid. قَال هَاتُ. Bring your question. So they said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَخْبِرْنَا عَنْ عَلَامَةِ النَّبِيِّ. This prophet that's supposed to come, tell us about his sign. He said, تَنَامُ عَيْنَا وَلَا يَنَامُ قَلْبُهُ. His eyes will sleep, but his heart never sleeps. The Yahud, they said, أَخْبِرْنَا كَيْفَ. Tell us, how is it when a woman conceives? It's a male or a female child. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَلْتَقِي الْمَاءَن. The two water, the water of the man and the water of the woman, they meet. فَإِذَا عَلَى مَاءُ الرَّجُلُ مَاءَ الْمَرْأَةِ. If the water of the man is above that the water of the woman, it is a what? Male child. And if it's the other way around, the water of the woman goes on top of the water of the man, it's a what? A female child. They said, tell us that which Israel حَرَّمَ عَلَى نَفْسِ, which he made haram upon himself. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answered, لُحُوم, the meat of the camel and the milk of the camel. After that, they said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَخْبِرْنَا مَا هَذَا رَعْد. Tell us, what is this الرَعْد? What's رَعْد? The thunder, the strike. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَلَكُ مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. The رَعْد is an angel from the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, مُوَكَّلْ بِالصَّحَاب, that's in charge of moving the sahab, the cloud. بِيَدِهِ أَوْ فِي يَدِهِ مِخْرَاق, in his hand is something which is like a sword. That مِن نَارٍ, from fire. That he pushes with it السحاب, the cloud. يَسُوقُهُ حَيْثَ أَمَرَ اللَّهُ. He pushes wherever Allah Ta'ala he wills. قَالُوا فَمَا هَذَا الصَّوْتُ الَّذِي يُسْمَعُ. And what about this noise that is heard? قَالَ صَوْتُهُ. This is his noise, the noise which he makes. Who makes this noise? The angel. And that's why when you hear the thunder, for the young children here, for my students at the back there, Ash-Shuyukh Al-Qadim, the next generation of Shuyukh, inshaAllah ta'ala, what is the dua you make when you hear a thunder strike? This is contain the thunder. Yeah, Abdullah. طيب. Or the dhikr you make. Ya Abdul Rahman. طيب. So both of them are only being called of people's children. Subhana alladhi yusabbihu al-ra'd. One of the things the ra'd does is what? Glorifies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yusabbihu al-ra'd bihamdihi, by the praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wal malaika min khifatihi. Min khifatihi. طيب. This is the dua of al-ra'd when you hear the thunder. طيب. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is ayah number 97. So the Yahud, they continue to ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They say, فَأَخْبِرْنَا مَنْ صَاحِبُكَ. Tell us, who is your companion? Who is your guardian? قَالْ, that comes to you with news. Because there's not a prophet. إِلَّا وَلَهُ malak. There's not a prophet, he says a malak. يَأْتِيهِ بِالْخَبَرِ. That brings news to him. So who is the one? They said, the Prophet said, Jibreel alayhi salam. It is Jibreel. So the Yahud said to him, before this question, if you answer this fifth question, khalas, we're going to follow you. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Jibreel, they said, Jibreel, ذَاكَ الَّذِي يَنْزِلُ بِالْحَرْبِ. Jibreel, the one that comes down with harb, with war. وَالْقِتَالِ, and killing. وَالْعَذَابِ, and punishment. عَدُوُّنَا, is our enemy. لو قلت ميكائيل, if you said ميكائيل, one that comes out with mercy, والنبات, and plantation, and water, لكان. This would have been the correct answer. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the ayah, مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِجِبْرِيلِ, whoever is an enemy to Jibreel, فَإِنَّهُ نَزَّلَهُ عَلَى قَلْبِكَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, is the one that brought this Quran down from your heart by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ وَهُدًى وَبُشْرًى لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And if they have no excuse to say ميكائيل, they love. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِلَّهِ, whoever is an enemy to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning, you cannot be an ally to Allah and be an enemy to Jibreel. مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِلَّهِ, whoever is an enemy to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ, and his angels. وَرُسُلِهِ, and his messenger. وَمِيكَائِيل وَجِبْرِيل, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَدُوٌ لِلْكَافِرِينَ. Allah is an enemy to the kafirin. In the same way, you cannot deny one prophet and you say you believe in one of the prophets. And what is the proof of this? That if you disbelieve in one prophet, you disbelieve in all the prophets. What is the proof of this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كَذَّبَ قَوْمُ نُوحٍ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. The people of Nuh, they denied all the messengers. How did they deny the messengers? Who was the first messenger to mankind? Nuh. So how did they deny the other messengers? How did they deny the other messengers? By denying Nuh. Whoever denies Nuh has denied all the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whether the enemy to Jibreel and the Yahud, they also enter to Mika'il, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and all the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you're going to see later on the dangers, and we're going to go through this seerah, the attributes of Aqidah al-Yahudiyah, Jewish creed and belief. This is the important Aqidah. That people that adopted this Aqidah later on, such as Shia, you see in some of their practices. So, for example, when we're giving salam in the salah, taslim, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. You have some sects or group of the Shia, if you watch them praying, other than the stone they put on the floor, they do this. At that moment, they're cursing Jibreel. Because amongst the Shia are those that say the Quran should be given to Ali and not the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this Aqidah of cursing Jibreel is from who? Al-Yahud, the Jews. As from the surah, or the durus from this surah, the lessons from this surah. Inshallah, we stop here. There are three lessons from this surah, but the brothers, they look tired. This is the first day. Or if you want me to continue, I could continue. We could do the lessons from the surah, and then we'll go back to the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and look at this aqidah al-yahudiyah, these Jewish traits, trace of al-hasad, trace of jealousy. Yes? Trace of what? Jealousy. Which is jealousy is an issue of aqidah, yes or no? It's an issue of aqidah, issue of belief, jealousy. Because a jealous person, he thinks Allah should have given me and not him. He doubts the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Yahud, that jealousy took them to what level? وَدَّ كَثِيرٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ لَوْ يَرُدُّونَكُمْ مِّنْ بَعْدِ إِيمَانِكُمْ كُفَّارًا. Many people of the book, they wish you could make you go back to kuffar after iman. Why? حَسَدًا مِّنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِهِمْ, out of jealousy in their hearts. These traits, or Jewish traits, they're present in some aspect or some people in the ummah. And that's why Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, when it comes to saying of Allah Azza wa Jal, غَيْرُ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ, those who Allah's anger is upon. What's the tafsir? What those Allah's anger is upon, Ya Abdullah? In Surah Al-Fatiha, who are they? Abdullah. Abdurrahman, sahibuhu. Who are they? Huh? Ya Abdurrahman. Those, when Allah Ta'ala says, غَيْرُ مَقْدُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ, those whose anger is upon. What group of people is this concerning? Na'am. Jazakallah khairan ya Mus'ab. The Jews. Jazakallah khairan. Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, مَقْدُوب عَلَيْهِمْ الْيَهُودِ وَمَنْ تَبِعَهُمْ, and whoever follows the Jews. So many of the time think Jews. No, whoever follows their attributes. Jayid. And the attributes of them, as the ulama, they say, that man fasada min ulama'ina, whoever goes astray from those who know, from the scholars, fihi shabahu min al-yahud, he has a trait of the Jews, those who know, but they don't act upon their knowledge. Wal-dalin al-nasara, those who act, but they do not know, or whoever follows them. And that's why the ulama say, man fasada min ubadina, those who are devoted to the worship of Allah, that go astray, they have similarity to the who? The Christians, because they act without knowledge. So this surah, Al-Madaniyah, we're going to go to a lot in, inshallah ta'ala, and it shows the importance of knowledge. Because the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, other than the excellences that's been mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah, about Surah Al-Baqarah, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, when it comes to Huffaz, they had a different understanding to the one, A'lamu bi kitabillah, the one who understands the book of Allah most. Nowadays, the one that's memorized the most, Jayid, as we understood. The Sahaba, when it comes to leading the Salah, when they say, A'lamuhum bi kitabillah, the most knowledgeable concerning the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not the one that's done what? That's memorized the most. The one that does what? Understood the most. The Sahaba, it took them 10 years, some of them, to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah. 10 years. Why? They'll act upon it, know its meaning, the rules and regulations. So they used to say, the Sahaba, whoever's memorized Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Ali Imran, I think, or Nisa, or one of those, two of them at least, or three, is from the fuqaha, the people of fiqh, the Sahaba. You have those three, lots of ahkam in there. So when it comes to leading the Salah, أَعْلَمُهُمْ بِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ, in their understanding, not the one that's memorized the most, but the one that understands the most, because of rules and regulation. For example, you have a hafiz there, a boy, maybe he's 10 years old, is a hafiz, this is a salah. Jayid? And you have somebody else, is memorized Baqarah, Ali Imran, but he's a faqih, he understands the deen. Jayid? So the 10-year-old boy is leading the salah. Something happens in salah, for example. He breaks his wudu, a 10-year-old boy, and he's leading everybody in salah. He doesn't necessarily have the understanding to know what to do. He makes a mistake in salah. Sujood al-sahu, is it before? Is it after? What do I do? Is there sujood al-sahu? He says something wrong? He can't. So the one that leads salah is responsible for the salah of who? The other people. So the issue of al-imama, leadership of leading salah, is not just simply what? Remember, understand the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanakallah bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Any questions, inshallah? Naam. No.